Hello dear student, this is Dr. Agnes John Karat from MGV's Arts, Science and Commerce College, Surgana. With me, we'll begin with new course of Zoology, Parasitology. Let us begin with the first chapter, Introduction. In this chapter, we will learn about scope and branches of parasitology. In particular, we are supposed to learn definition of host, parasite, vector, commensalism, mutualism and parasitism. So, first we will learn what is parasitology. There are different definitions of parasitology. Parasitology is the branch of zoology which deals with the study of parasitic animals. Parasitology is the branch of biology which is concerned with the phenomenon of dependence of one living organism on another. So it is study of parasites, their host, and relationship between them. So this is the most important thing which we are supposed to remember about parasitology, that it is study of parasite, their host, and the relationship between them. So slowly we will learn about this three aspect, that is, what is parasite, what is host, and relationship among parasite and host. So, parasite is an organism that lives on or in its host, which is usually a larger organism that provides physical protection and nourishment to that organism. So, what is parasite? It is an organism which depends on other organism either for physical protection or for the nourishment. What is host? Host is the organism from which a parasite obtains its nutrition or shelter. Host is an organism which harbors the parasite in or on its own body. Thus, host supports the life of the parasite and parasite derives the benefit at the expense of the host, that is, at the cost of the host. In any parasitic relationship, parasite is always benefited and the host is injured or harmed. In parasite-host relationship, host is generally larger partner than the parasite. Hence, parasite obtains various benefits such as shelter, nutrition, reproduction and development from the host body. The parasite depends on the host and permanent host parasitic relationship is formed between them. So here now we know what is host. It is the organism from which the parasite is going to obtain its nutrition, or either it will depend on that particular organism for shelter or for the protection. What is classification of host? There are different categories of the host. First category is intermediate host. Host in which larval stages of parasite lives or asexual multiplication takes place. For example, man in case of the malaria. Intermediate host in which only larval stages of parasite is going to live and only asexual multiplication will take place. Always remember, in the intermediate host, sexual kind of reproduction of parasite will not take place. Second category is definitive host. In definitive host, it either harbors the adult stage of parasite or where the parasite utilizes sexual method of reproduction. So here we can say mosquito is definitive host in case of malaria. Reservoir host. Reservoir host, it harbors the parasite and acts as an important source of infection to other susceptible host. For example, dog is reservoir host of hydatid disease. Next is paratenic host. Paratenic host is also called as transport host. It is a host where parasite remains viable without further development. So it is just a carrier or a transport organism for the parasite. These are the four categories we have learned. Now we'll see what is parasite. Parasite is an organism that lives on or in its host, which is usually a larger organism that provides physical protection and nourishment. So, a parasite is a living organism. It can either be animal or plant, which receives the nourishment and shelter partly or wholly from other organism, which is called as its host, where it lives. The host is an organism which harbors the parasite. Thus, parasites are metabolically dependent on their host and derive benefit from the host. What is vector? Vectors are carriers of parasites. Vectors are carriers of parasite. They play very important role in transmission of parasite from one host to the other host. Basically, vectors transfer the parasite from one host to another. Thus, vectors are acting as a carrier of parasites. They play an important role of mechanical transmitter. The term vector is also described almost all kinds of host except definitive host. So, we can use the term vector is used to describe almost all kinds of host except definitive host. Arthropods and many other invertebrates that serves as host as well as carriers for protozoans and other smaller parasites are referred as vectors. For example, various species of mosquitoes serves as vectors for the protozoan malarial parasites. Plasmodium species, Culex mosquito transmit, Wuchereria bancrofti, that is Filaria. So these are the examples of vectors. So now we will learn types of vector. The first type of vector is biological vector. An insect may not only be a vector of a disease producing organism, but the germs of parasite undergo some developmental changes in the body of insects or may multiply in it. Such process is termed as biological transmission and the vector is called biological vector. The example is Plasmodium species, which is a malarial parasite. It undergoes a cycle of development in the mosquito. The next category of vector type is mechanical vector. The vector which transmit the parasite from one host to another without any development of pathogen in their body is called as mechanical vectors. That means in mechanical vector, only mechanical transmission of the parasite will happen. There will not occur any developmental stage in this mechanical vector. For example, housefly carry variety of disease causing germs on their bodies and carry them to a host and they transfer the germs through their saliva, fecal matter, their body parts. The houseflies are dangerous and transmit organisms which cause diarrhea, typhoid, bacillary and amoebic dysentery and cholera. There are different types of association. Symbiosis. It is an association in which both are so dependent upon each other that one cannot live without the help of the other organism. So this is called as symbiotic kind of association in which both organisms involved in the association, they are dependent on each other. They cannot live without each other. commensalism. It is an association in which the parasite only is deriving benefit without causing injury to its host. That means in commensalism type of association, only one organism, which is parasite, will obtain benefit from the host, whereas on the other side, host will remain unharmed. Parasitism. It is an association in which the parasite derives benefit and host gets nothing in return but always suffer some kind of injury, however slight injury it may be. Commensalism. These are some of the examples now we are going to learn. Commensalism, here one organism receives and benefit from the other while the other will remain unharmed, or other neither gets benefits nor is harmed. The example is egret. It eats the insect kicked up by the cow and it moves. The egret got food while the cow was not affected. It remained unharmed. Sparrows benefit from the fierce hawk called osprey by setting up home below it for the protection. Commensalism, this term literally means eating at the same table. It is a loose form of association for getting shelter, food and defense. Association that is beneficial to one partner and at least not disadvantageous to the another is called as the commensalism. It is a relation between two kinds of organisms in which one obtains food or other benefits from the other without damaging it. When two or more animals live together and if there is no physiological dependence between them, they are referred as commensals. So commensals which are simply attached to the outer surface of the host are called as ectocommensals because they remain attached to the outer surface of the host body. And if the commensals are found inside the host body, they are termed as endocommensals. So there are two kinds of commensals, ectocommensals and endocommensals. So commensalism, it is only one organism gets benefit and the other is not affected. The example is hermit crab. It lives in the shells made and then abandoned by the snails. This relationship neither helps nor harms the snail. The second association is mutualism. Here, both the partners in the association are benefited. It is this association may be continuous, transitory, obligatory, or facultative. Animal shows metabolic interdependence, hence they live together by their existence. For example, mutualism is wood-eating termites and presence of flagellate protozoans in their alimentary canal. In case of association, antagonism, one of the species is harmed. The relationship of antagonism between species includes neutrality, antibiosis, and parasitism. So this is example of mutualistic symbiosis. These are clownfishes. Clownfish are hiding in an anemone. Clownfish and anemones live together in a mutualistic symbiotic relationship. They protect each other from the predators. This is again one more example of mutualistic symbiosis. An Argentine ant is farming aphids on a young leaf. The ants feed on honeydew and the aphid receives protection from ants. Next kind of association is parasitism. An association between the organisms in which one organism lives on or another organism's utilizing its nourishment is called as the parasitism. In this association, the parasite derives benefits. It is one-sided dependence and usually nutritional. Parasites never kill its host but share its food. In parasitism, live and let live is the basic principle. What are the advantages of parasitism? Host body is best shelter for parasite because it protects the parasite from environment. It provides constant ample food to the parasite. It's assured constant environment for parasite, because of that parasite reproduces enormously. Warm-blooded host provides this condition better. What are the hazards of parasitism? Survival of parasite, it has to reach the suitable host, otherwise it will perish or it will die. So for the survival of parasite, it is very important that it should get a suitable host. The parasite adapt to host reaction. The parasite has to adapt to the host reaction. Parasite has reached to suitable place for grow and become mature. After maturation, parasite face problems in finding the mate or reproduction. Overpopulation, it is one more hazardous condition. Overpopulation in host. Hosts suffer from hyperinfestation, which leads to death of the host and ultimately death of the parasite. Parasite should release the eggs, larvae and juveniles out of the host body in order to continue its life cycle. So these are the hazards of parasitism. There are different branches. One is medical protozoology. Due to malaria, millions of people die in the world. Protozoa also causes diseases in animals. Diseases are more prevalent in the tropical and subtropical regions. All classes of protozoa have disease producing members, but they are more in flagellata and sporozoa. Example is amoebiasis, diarrhea, trypanosomiasis, leishmaniasis, toxoplasmosis, palintidial dysentery. These are the various diseases caused by protozoans in human being. So medical protozoology, it is one of the important branch of the parasitology. And these are some of the examples of protozoans: Entamoeba histolytica, Leishmania, Toxoplasma, Trichomonas, Trypanosoma, Giardia, Toxoplasma gondii, Palintidium. So these are the protozoan parasites which are pathogenic to man. Entamoeba histolytica, its habitat is large intestine. It causes dysentery and liver abscesses. Giardia intestinalis, habitat is small intestine, causes diarrhea. Trichomonas vaginalis, habitat is vagina and causes vaginitis. Trypanosoma brucei, habitat is blood and lymph node. It causes African sleeping sickness. Leishmania donovani, central nervous system, reproductive system, and it causes kalazar. Leishmania tropica, generally its habitat is skin. It causes oriental sore. Plasmodium vivax, its habitat is RBCs. It causes Benign pterinian malaria. Isospora belli, habitat is epithelial cells of intestine, and its pathogenic effect is diarrhea. Toxoplasma gondii, reproductive system, and its pathogenic effect is encephalomyelitis. Medical helminthology, it is another branch of parasitology. It is the branch of medical science which deals with the study of helminth parasite of medical importance to human being. Helminths are very common endoparasites of human being found in all parts of the world. Helminth parasite are divided into two groups, platyhelminthes and nematohelminthes. Platyhelminthes are flatworms, which includes various cystoid worms like tania and trematodes, which are called as liver flukes. Nematohelminthes includes roundworms like Ascaris, Filaria, Trichinella, Dunia worms. All the helminths are endoparasites of gut and blood in the human body and cause various diseases which are collectively called as helminthiasis. The diseases caused by the nematode worms constitute nematodiasis. The disease caused by the nematode worms constitute nematodiasis, and the examples are Encyclostoma duodenal. Both of them, they are Encyclostoma duodenal. This is Schistosoma. Both male and female union is there in the diagram. Trematode. These are also helminth which cause diseases called as trematodiasis. So, schistosomiasis caused by Schistosoma mansoni. Fasciolasis caused by Fasciola hepatica. Paragonimiasis caused by lung fluke, and ophthalmoptosis caused by Chinese liver fluke. This is diagram of Fasciola hepatica. Tapeworm. These are responsible for cystodiasis, teniasis. It is caused by Tenia solium, pork tapeworm, and Tenia saginata. It is a beef tapeworm. Echinococcosis, which is called as hydrated cyst, is the disease caused by larval cysts of Echinococcus granulosus. So these are the helminth parasite and their symptoms. The name of the disease is ascariasis, which is caused by parasite Ascaris lubricoides roundworm, and symptoms are urticarial rash, appendicitis. Second is Encyclostomiasis caused by Encyclostoma duodenal, hookworm it is. Symptoms are dermatitis, gastrointestinal disorder, and anemia. Enterobiasis, parasite is Enterobius vermiculus, pinworm which is pinworm it is called as, and symptoms are severe itching around anus, loss of appetite, and sleeplessness. The fourth disease is trichuriasis, which is caused by parasite Trichuris trichura, which is a whipworm, and symptoms are acute appendicitis, diarrhea. Trichinosis, which is caused by parasite Trichinella spiralis, and symptoms are eosinophilia, muscle pain, and swelling of eyelids. Strongyloidiasis, which is called by Strongylodesister coralis, which is called as a thread worm commonly. Symptoms are dermatitis, vomiting, and diarrhea. Filariasis is caused by filarial worm Wuchereria bancrofti, and symptoms are enlargement of the limbs, scrotum, mammary gland. Loasis caused by parasite Loa loa, eye worm. It causes the symptoms swelling of lids, itching, and pain. Medical entomology. Medical entomology is the branch of science which deals with the study of harmful insects to man and his domestic animals, their morphology, life cycle, and pathogenic effects or disease caused by them. Insects cause diseases in two ways. They bring harmful effect by destroying tissues of their host, and some insect can transmit disease-producing bacteria and protozoans. Examples are houseflies, mosquitoes, bugs, fleas, lice, etc. These are the insects which acts as a vector. Several species of mosquitoes are vectors of human malaria. Flies like houseflies transmit germs of typhoid, cholera, dysentery, and diarrhea. Glossina or tsetse fly is the vector of trypanosoma from animals to man, causing disease African sleeping sickness. The rat flea Xenopsylla transmit bacilli of bubonic plague to the man. The human louse Pediculus humanus is blood sucking which carries rickettsia, which causes trench fever, and spirochetes, causing relapsing fever in man. Lice are also responsible for epidemic and endemic typhus in human being. Ticks and mites comprise one of the largest and most important orders of phylum Arthropodan. They are ectoparasites of vertebrate animals, including man. They all suck the blood as well as transmit various diseases like typhus, virus encephalitis, viral fevers, tularemia, human babesiosis, Q fever, etc. So these are the examples of arthropod vectors: Xenopsylla, Sarcoptis scabby, sassafly, housefly, lice, tick. Then the most important branch of parasitology is forensic entomology. It is actually applied branch of parasitology, forensic entomology. It is the recent branch of applied entomology in which the study of insects and other arthropods found in and on human bodies suspected of criminal action to help in the investigation and initiation of civil proceedings. Thus, during investigation, the stages of insects on the dead body can give clue to the time since death. In this, there are many arthropods are included in this forensic entomology. Examples are dipterian flies like winter gnats, blowfly, screwworm, fleshfly, coleopteran beetles, lepidopteran moths, hymenopteran insects like ants and wasps, and even cockroaches. They give exact sign and we can predict time since death. So these are the examples of forensic entomology: winter gnat, moth, blowfly, screwworm, wasp, beetle. Thank you.